Welcome. I'm Scott Reed, President and CEO of the Music Academy of the West, and I'm so delighted to welcome all of you to the second annual Fast Pitch. Fast Pitch gives our Music Academy fellows the opportunity to present entrepreneurial and innovative ideas that can make an impact in the world of classical music and beyond. Being innovative in the arts is an important component of the Music Academy's training program. We encourage our fellows to bring their new ideas on music performance, social impact, audience development, and education to our program so we can provide them tools to launch their concepts and be agents of change in our industry. Fast Pitch serves as an introduction to a larger grant program we have at the Music Academy, our Alumni Enterprise Awards. This program invites Music Academy alumni to present full business concepts for funding. Awards range between $2,500 and $20,000 per project. In its third year, the Music Academy Alumni Enterprise Award Program has provided $220,000 to 21 alumni to support their innovative business projects. We hope our Fast Pitch participants and all of our fellows this summer will further develop their concepts and apply for an Alumni Enterprise Award this fall. After a preliminary round of judging earlier this week, the seven fellows you will hear tonight were selected to present their pitches as part of this evening's Concert Hall Online. Following each pitch video you will hear this evening, all panels' judges will ask questions of our finalists. After all seven pitches are complete, two things will happen. Our online audience will have the opportunity to vote for their favorite pitch, and our judges will deliberate and name three winners based on project innovation, potential for impact, and industry need. The judges will also consider presentation style and each fellow's ability to convey their ideas. Our three winners will receive a $1,500 cash prize and the opportunity to attend the Music Academy's Innovation Residential in March of next year. The Innovation Residential is a five-day training program where our winners will workshop their concepts with business mentors, as well as receive legal counseling, training in fundraising, and coaching on product design. We are so pleased to have such an impressive roster of judges with us this evening. Please join me in welcoming Clive Chang, Ariel Davis, Nadia Sirota, and Dean Carter, who will now introduce themselves to our online audience.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Clive Chang. I am Chief of Staff and Innovation at Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts in New York City and a proud Music Academy of the West board member. I myself am a classically trained pianist and composer, and I'm delighted to be here with you this evening.
Hello, everyone. I'm also really excited to be able to hear your pitches. My name is Ariel Davis, and I've worked at the Kennedy Center on the Social Impact and Community Programming team. I've also had experience working with small organizations and independent artists in order to help them leverage their brands and do marketing and management. I am also a reformed French horn player. My biggest claim to fame is playing with Lizzo at the Grammys in January. So again, I'm just really excited to meet you all today.
Wow, Ariel, I'm super starstruck. That was a great performance. My name is Nadia Sirota. I am a violist and a curator and a broadcaster. As a violist, I am a soloist. I mostly work with composers and new works that I like to commission. I'm also in the group Y Music, which is a chamber sextet that works with composers and also bands and songwriters. So we went on tour over the past 5 years or so with Ben Folds and most recently with Paul Simon. I had a podcast that actually won a Peabody Award called Meet the Composer. And I've been doing a quarantine variety show on Facebook called Living Music, which you can check out. And I'm currently the New York Philharmonic's creative partner. So I curate and host two concert series of chamber music for them.
I'm Dean Carter, and I'm the head of human resources, legal, and finance for Patagonia. But I have the honor of being on the board for the past 3 years, and this is my second year with Fast Pitch. I'm a very bad fiddle player, but I'm trying very hard, and I enjoy it very much. So I'm glad to be a part of this today.
Hello, my name is Lauren Keating, and I am so excited to share my project with you all, the Oboe Excerpt Exercise Book. An excerpt is a brief snippet of music from the most famous classical repertoire that a musician must perfectly execute at an orchestra audition. The skills and discipline required to master these excerpts is akin to the preparation and training of a professional athlete. Any musician's dream of playing in an orchestra hinges on their ability to do this under high pressure. My exercise book includes practice solutions that get to the root of an excerpt's challenges and help accelerate the learning process. The book also provides relevant information on the composer, the piece, and a thorough score analysis of the excerpt in the context of the orchestra. The reason this project is important is because no other book out there is this in-depth about the best ways to practice these excerpts, and they do not dive into the holistic relationship of solo to score. The synthesis of information on the piece also cuts down on hours of research by the auditionee, saving that valuable time for the practice room. Here's the planned layout. Page 1 will provide a historical introduction and the exercises that simplify the most difficult passages with key reminders above to ensure successful execution. Page 2 will provide the score for the excerpt, as well as relevant harmonic analysis and contextualization. Page 3 will provide the excerpt as it is printed for auditions, with key reminders written throughout the solo and a summary.
So, why has no one done this? Well, there are books that cover some of these needs, but not all of them. They do not discuss these excerpts as holistically as need be, and the solutions to executing them well. I believe the world looks much different than when our last excerpt book was printed in 2006. We live in a more technologically advanced world, and our field has continued to grow increasingly more competitive without enough innovation in our learning methods. This book offers a modern approach to being your own teacher, a one-stop shop for all your audition needs. Because I want to create an easier path for those who have the heart and the grit to compete in this industry. By offering both print and online components, this publication will embrace and adapt the demands of the industry. I'm working on this book with my teacher Robert Atherhole, former principal oboist of the Houston Symphony and esteemed pedagogue at Rice University. My target audience for this book is teachers and students alike. The International Double Reed Society has over 13,000 members on Facebook, many of whom are oboe students and teachers. I plan on getting testimonials from oboists in the Cleveland Orchestra and the Chicago Symphony. Thank you for considering my project for this pivotal opportunity and for considering the impact this would have on the oboe community.
Hi, Lauren. Thank you so much for that pitch. And I have the distinct honor of asking the first question to you. And just a note that the oboe happens to be my favorite orchestral instrument, so you're in good hands here.
Yeah, wonderful.
The question I'd love to ask you is about long-term impact. And you touched on this a little bit in your pitch, but wonder if you could expand a bit. So if you fast forward 10 years from now, what impact do you think this project has had on the world and beyond the professional, semi-professional, sort of advanced academic realm, perhaps, and perhaps even beyond just the oboe community?
Sure. I mean, I have a long-term plan for this in terms of I believe this book provides a really good fundamental start, like the building blocks of a good oboe player, and it will cut down on inefficient practicing, so ultimately everyone is going to be getting better because they're focused on the fundamentals of what it is to be not only a good oboe player, but also a good musician. So it elevates the level of playing, which I think we all can appreciate. My plans are actually to expand upon this, like with the website component, keeping it relevant constantly, and including information that's pertinent to the changes in the auditions and in the industry. And then after this, I would hope to also expand to like second oboe excerpts. There's no book for that anywhere. English horn excerpts. And then partnering perhaps with other instruments to do similar books, because ultimately we all go to school to learn how to practice more efficiently to be our own teachers. And it's why I've been in school for so long. It's trying to figure out the best ways to be the best player. So I think this book will have the impact of teaching people how to be their own teachers faster.
Thank you.
Hi there, this is a really awesome project. I'm curious, you mentioned the website being a part of, you know, like helping to market the book and et cetera. Are there any other digital platforms that you plan on using to just like share some of those learning modules with others?
Yeah, I actually would hope, I mean, I'm gonna have a website portion for it. I would like to have an Instagram, a Facebook, maybe even a Twitter. I've never had a Twitter, so we'll see. And also, like, the great thing I think about the website is that it will have multimedia options to listen to performers actually doing the things that I'm trying to teach about in the book. So that'll be like YouTube, Spotify, Apple Music, as available.
Awesome, thank you.
Wondering if you're thinking about like ultimately monetizing this, or this is something you want to put out into the world for free, or how do you imagine this being distributed or sort of sustainable financially?
There are a couple different ways that I've been thinking about this. What I would like to do is actually use the website as the sort of the pitch as to why you should have this book. And it'll be like an extension of all of the things that I talk about in the book, but it will maybe provide like one example of what you would get in terms of, because I think the thing that makes it really special is the solutions to the practice, like the exercises themselves. So I'll show one of those and then have either a downloadable PDF on the website, like that's pretty much a given, or work with a publisher in order to allow people to download it maybe once or twice per purchase. Another thing I was also thinking about is licensing, like a year's worth of downloading this if you are an oboe teacher who doesn't want to continue to pay for this over and over again, then you can use it for a year and, you know, update annually.
Right on. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Jay Julio, and I'm a strings player from New York. I'm a first-generation Filipino-American college student, the nephew of a formerly incarcerated individual, and the founder of Sound Off, Music for Bail. Sound Off brings together classical music audiences, musicians, formerly incarcerated individuals, families, and activists in the space of a monthly Zoom concert. $12 tickets are sold to the general public to raise funds for the National Bail Fund and the Bail Project, while admission is offered free of charge for families and people affected by the U.S. prison complex. How do we bring these seemingly disparate communities together? After conversations with a featured speaker, either someone who has had experience within the prison system or an activist in the field, a musical program reflecting the content of their lecture is drafted. 30 minutes of music, a 15-minute testimonial from our speaker, and then another 20 minutes of music. In less than an hour, audiences can hear a Florence Price or Shostakovich quartet combined with a real person's story, informing and transforming the music. Then, in a post-concert talkback, audiences are invited to share in dialogue with the speaker and musicians to learn more about the issue and how to get involved. Now, what is Sound Off's issue? Two words, cash bail. For the average individual accused of a felony as violent as in New York, being in possession of over 8 ounces of non-medicinal marijuana, cash bail means paying the court $10,000 out of pocket or otherwise staying months in jail pre-trial. The median annual pre-incarceration income for a white man unable to meet bail is $18,283. For a black woman, $9,083. Jail often is the result of poverty, not crime. Our primary beneficiaries, the National Bail Fund and the Bail Project, go inside the system, finding people there right now who have financial need and directly pay their bail. Sound Off works on the outside of prisons, giving people who haven't yet encountered the prison system an opportunity to hear from people who have while funneling money to the cause. Now, each one of our concerts takes $1,000 to produce. Our target this year is 50 audience members per concert, $600 raised in an hour. We're targeting Facebook ads to music lovers, reaching out to spaces like the Church of Gethsemane that directly support people that go through the prison system, posting flyers up in Hamilton Heights. But most of all, we rely on word of mouth from people like you. We've relied heavily on content donations from our strong base of musician support, on small private donors, and on fundraising events for our current operations. In the post-pandemic world, we'll be exploring in-person expansions to our offerings, fiscal sponsorship, and larger institutional support. What's more vital than any source of money, though, is growing an educated community of audiences, of musicians, of people. We're hoping that Sound Off is a community you'd like to be a part of.
I wonder if you look, I'm kind of playing off what Clive had asked. If you look forward, do you see how this could expand, like past the initial offering, to not just providing bail, but even policy changes and funding, work around getting rid of bail. Period. Is that something? Do you see there are other expansions for this beyond the work that's being done here?
Absolutely, Mr. Carter. As a matter of fact, one of our partners, the Bail Project, has in its bylines eventually the abolition of cash bail, which is an institution that's quite unique actually to two countries, the US and the country of my family, the Philippines, which follows the US prison model. In terms of sizing up, each concert, of course, is modular. You can do it in person or online. So we're hopeful that similar to other organizations like Root Muse or So Far Sounds, that Sound Off concerts can be propagated through organic ways in terms of where they happen and when they happen. In terms of long reach goals, yes, we are looking at the abolition of cash bail. But this is, of course, something that isn't supported by a majority of Americans who oftentimes don't know what cash bail is. So we're doing baby steps.
Great, thank you.
Hi, Jay. Thank you for that pitch. What a wonderful project. You spoke a little bit about your outreach plans in terms of gaining some more audience. I was wondering if you had also given any thought to potential partners to help with execution of the actual events themselves as a means of achieving scale, along with your sort of audience outreach plans.
Absolutely. So actually, this is sort of built into what I'm doing over the next 3 years. I'll be starting a fellowship with the LA Chamber Orchestra, which also has partnerships with USC Thornton and with the Inner City Youth Orchestra of LA. So we're hoping to get these organizations also in partnership, as well as other organizations that I've passed through, Interlochen, Manhattan School of Music, Juilliard, as well as the Music Academy of the West, hopefully, to try and both advertise and also to garner more institutional financial support program.
Also, just wanted to chime in and say this is a really great project. Could you talk a little bit more about your short-term plans and similar to the last question I asked, what platforms you plan on really spending time on in order to get the word out about this project?
Actually, this Saturday, and everyone who's watching is super invited to come, we have our first fundraising event, which is a technique class that I'm giving on violin and viola. This is aimed towards beginner and intermediate students, and we're hoping that we can combine music education into our fundraisers as a way, of course, to reach both more audiences and younger and older audiences. In terms of platforms that we are using, we've already used Facebook. We're using Facebook marketing. We are targeting hashtags such as Black Lives Matter, prison reform, but also hashtags like Carnegie Hall, Chamber Music Society, Lincoln Center, to ensure that we're reaching a great variety of different people. As always, as I mentioned in my video, I really do deeply believe that grassroots organization is super important, particularly because we are dealing with a particularly victimized group of people. Incarceration is, as Angela Davis often says, sort of a stigma upon people, and it's really hard for families to talk about it. So we're not relying on things that are anonymous, like Facebook and Instagram, for connections with that community. We're looking at organizations that directly deal with the problems that face formerly incarcerated people uniquely, so that we can better service them.
Hi, I'm Alice Chung, and I'm a first-generation American. As a child of Korean immigrants and never having been to Korea, I learned about my culture and history through traditional dancing, my parents, countless dramas, and many karaoke nights. 2 months ago, in response to the upsurge in xenophobia and violence against Asians due to the COVID-19 pandemic, my colleagues and I founded the initiative Wear Yellow Proudly with the hope of raising awareness of the beautifully diverse cultures of Asia. As you can see on the screen, we do so in many ways, several of which feature artists of Asian heritage in the classical music industry. Inspired by the content in several Marley guest speakers, I wanted to program and record Korean folk songs because the beauty and drama is nothing short of operatic and should be an addition to the growing recital culture of classical singing. I found some, but none were programmable due to the difference in technique. Korean folk songs are sung with a style called pansori, which Western vocal technicians of the classical music industry may consider harmful, despite the large representation of Asians in the classical music industry compared to the other minorities. There is a lack in the musical representation of our heritage. So, as my project, I hope to bridge that gap as a gateway into the rich musical traditions of Korea. I have 3 goals that I want to accomplish through this project. First, I want to preserve and showcase the various and dying dialects of Korea by setting them with traditional modes if they are not already set in their own music. Second, I want to modernize or adapt folk songs that feature traditional melodies that can be healthfully sung by all singers of classical vocal technique. Third, I want to document the process, perform, record, and publish an anthology so that they are accessible through all mediums. Through these goals, I hope to expand the Korean art song repertoire selection for performers and engage more Western audiences with Korean culture and people. There are 3 stages to this project: compiling, commissioning, and creating. The first stage is to compile text and traditional folk melodies, as well as possible grants to fund this project. I will also be looking into finding potential composers and arrangers to commission for the second stage. Next is the composition and workshop process, with the goal of creating these pieces so they can be performed by classical musicians without compromising their technique. The last stage is to record, launch recital tours, and publish this anthology. These last 2 stages will be partially sponsored by Wear Yellow Proudly and its parent organization, Aural Compass Projects, and will require the most funding and connections to American and Korean presenters, publishers, recording spaces, and venues. As one of millions of Korean Americans, I have never seen my heritage represented in the Western classical music industry because it simply doesn't exist. We need representation of the traditional Korean sound that can easily be accessed, identified, and performed. I hope that through this project, the traditional sound of Korea will become more familiar and celebrated. Thank you.
Hello, Alice. Thank you so much for that.
Hi, thank you. Happy to be here.
So are you a vocalist yourself? I wasn't super...
Yes, I'm a mezzo-soprano.
Awesome. So I'm a little curious about the compiling part of this. So what does that research process entail, and where are you planning on finding all of this material?
So there is some online, and there is actually, there are resources that are not easily accessible through, for example, Netflix, but something on the Korean aspect of things called like Bravo TV or something like, or not Bravo, Baro TV. And they actually have a TV series in regarding and documenting all stuff of pansori. And currently I'm using that to see what is out there. And so the music and the text as well. And then if I am lacking in those sources, I may have to go and search them myself or through my connections in Korea.
Do you have access to somebody who is sort of very involved in this style, who can sort of serve as a guide and maybe push you in a certain direction to find some of this content?
I hope to make those connections a lot stronger. They're kind of one away, but I do have something, and I hope to be contacting them soon.
I wondered if you drew inspiration from other cultures that have done this very successfully, or ones that have not done this well successfully, that you go, okay, I'm going to take a different path for this. So I wondered where you may have gotten inspiration for where it's done well or has been more challenged in setting up your process.
Absolutely. You can actually go right here in the inspiration aspect in the States, that is, with different genres. For example, rap is based on the life of an life, and pansori and the themes of that is also based on just everyday life and what in opera we would probably call verismo and realism. And I feel like there have been more collaborations, like Pavarotti had hugely successful concerts, the Pavarotti and Friends, and I hope that this will bridge the gap more in terms of the Asian aspect, specifically the Koreans, because the Korean people actually have been separated for 40 years because of their occupation by Japan. And so I'm really hoping to push that forward.
Thank you.
Hi, Alice. Thank you so much for this. I hope that the answer from you will only take one, two, or three words. My question is, as the preservation of art often is a preservation of a vehicle or a symbol for expression of a culture's values or philosophies or morals or lessons, I'm wondering, through your project, if you were to pick one or two or three values or morals from the Korean culture that you hope are carried forward, what would they be?
I would probably say the preservation of how Korean people live, how it was back in the day, and where the melodies come from. Sorry, these aren't three words, but they're full sentences. But exactly like Pansori, they're an expression, and opera as well, they're an expression of how people feel. It's humanity. It's about being human.
Love it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hertz is a project rooted in the idea of listening in a different way. This project can be best described as a 20-minute electronic multimedia chamber opera in which the 52 Hertz whale recounts and explores humanity's impact on the planet after we're gone. And you can read more about the 52 Hertz whale online. This project is set in the ambiguous future, and the tone of its content is unapologetically bleak and resigned about where we are headed as a species. But it's our hope that this premise can make an audience uncomfortable in a constructive way and foster important conversations about the future of our Anthropocene. The concept of listening differently is present both in the content of the project and in the origin of it. The libretto features sound poetry, and the score relies heavily on Sprechgesang, and the track consists of a 52 Hertz pedal tone mixed with electronically manipulated whale calls, all forcing the audience to listen to these musical and extra-musical elements in a different way. But that concept also applies to the inception of the project, which, you should know, is decidedly absurd. We took these three videos playing at the same time and tried to frame it as serious art. The project is based on that sound world that you just heard, and we notated the textural and melodic elements from these three videos with the core instrumentation of a baritone soloist, piano, percussion, and electronic track. I was lucky enough to show this project to the visionary Claire Chase, who saw it as an invitation to listen differently both in regard to the ideas that it explores and its wild creation process, observing how it straddles the line between absurd and affecting, ridiculous and profound. The team for this project includes myself, Carl Henry, Joel Turning, Aaron Haygood, and the award-winning photographer Jasmine Carey. Here's just a taste of it. Jasmine and I imagined her photography being rendered through multiple projections that really envelop the audience and the experience. But we are also committed to the project being possible in any number of spaces, settings, or budgets, with the ensemble as large or small as desired. We aim to keep the opera as free and unconfined as it was when we first dreamt it up. So now I'd like to extend an invitation for you to join us and listen in a different way. Thank you.
That was a really great presentation. I'm wondering, with that work, and you know, with the environmental support that WALES provide, if you've considered working with advocacy groups around environmentalism or just that sure. social impact work, if you could talk about
sure. that. Yeah, so we are not directly connected to any group at the moment, but a group that we've been looking into is 350.org. And the particular reason is, and I wish I had the quote up here, is the founder of that organization said that it's not enough to just be intellectually informed about environmental issues, that that art needs to be at the cutting edge of it. And the quote that he said is like, where are the plays? Where are the goddamn operas? And so that was kind of an answer. We're trying to provide like an answer to that question, to that problem.
My question is, what is the 52 Hertz whale? You said I could Google it, but I haven't had time. So
sure. So the 52 Hertz whale is a whale that is emitting a call at 52 Hertz, which is much higher than other whales, and so it's kind of alone in the world. And scientists have been following it. It's an unknown species, and whales can live for up to several hundred, 200 years. And so ostensibly we're imagining that this is this special mythical, not mythical, but a legendary whale that is recounting the stages of humanity, the impact of humanity, kind of a pay into humans' time on Earth in this project, if that answers your question.
It does, and I think I remember that. How long is the piece in your conception?
20 minutes.
20 minutes.
There's certainly powerful power in film to make change, particularly around the environment when people connected. I wonder, is, you know, not that opera has to have a call to action, but is there some call to action with this that could be connected, or even around listening differently? Like, what do you want people to feel or perhaps do after participating or experiencing this?
Sure. So this the ideas behind what the project is about is even more of a reflection of how many we didn't just want to be another ineffective call to action. And so we try and synthesize, especially in the libretto, like kind of how many calls to action that have been on it, you know, our progress remains static. And that these calls to action are ineffective, and that this one is maybe more resigned about it, which would make it a more profound call to action because its resignation, because of its perhaps bleakness about our current path and how stuck we seem in it. But something else that I would that I wanted to draw attention to is also about the creation process and about how this type of art is about like legitimizing the creation process and the possibilities that can be spun out of like accessible media and everyday content. Like I've shown this to friends of mine in high school who have no interest in going to a classical music concert, but who say that they would go and see something like this because it's different, to which I try and explain that this is kind of the way classical music has always been. This is very much within that gesture. And so it shows that serious art like isn't elitist and it isn't inaccessible, and like anyone can stumble onto something that is profound, and that the profundity can be ascribed to a direction that's important in our current day.
Hey there, my name is Allison Rye, and I am a freelance oboist currently based in Chicago. Recently, the International Double Reed Society, or IDRS, posted the repertoire for the 2021 Julie Fox competition, and yet again, that list lacked representation of women and BIPOC composers. The uproar from members was so great that IDRS had to rescind and has since updated that list. Following this, I decided to do some of my own digging into our solo oboe repertoire, and what I found was that it includes only a handful of pieces by women, even fewer by composers of color, only one regularly performed piece by a Black composer, and none by a Black woman. I also discovered that every woodwind instrument has a commissioning consortium organization, except oboe. This exclusivity and resulting lack of representation is why I am creating a new oboe music commissioning consortium. I will use my Marley stipend to commission a major solo oboe work by an emerging underrepresented composer, and I will premiere that work at Music Academy of the West in 2021. I pledge to then commission one work every 2 years by way of the consortium. In order to center BIPOC voices, I will assemble an advisory council of at least 3 established musicians from varying backgrounds who can offer insight and leadership for the consortium's projects. I will also establish an international coalition of at least 5 emerging oboists who will pledge future involvement with the consortium and will perform the 2021 composition during a live-streamed online event. The event will conclude with a roundtable discussion with the composer, the performers, and the advisory council, where we will discuss the efforts of the consortium, as well as stories, ideas, and musical decisions all related to the composition. Any funds raised within the next 2 to 3 years will be accepted through Fractured Atlas as a fiscal sponsor, and establishing the consortium as a 501c3 organization will be considered after that time. To conclude, the consortium will break the barriers of our current repertoire by amplifying underrepresented voices of emerging artists, and I would be honored and privileged to have the support of the Music Academy of the West family. Thank you so much.
Hi, Allison. Thank you so much for that. Mm-hmm. I think the oboe gods really read my heart tonight and allowed me to be the opening question for both of these oboe projects, so I'm very happy about that. Your project is it's inspiring because it's about lifting and amplifying new voices and unheard voices. And I love that so much. My question to you is about reach, because, you know, I think about if a tree falls in the forest and there's no one to hear, did the tree really fall, right? And so how are you thinking about scale and reach and impact? And are you thinking at all about the genres of music that this commissioning initiative would consider bringing into the fold as a means of potentially expanding the base of the audience pool?
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that question. I think that in terms of a 5-year plan and a 10-year plan, I think the oboe industry has a lot to improve on, and we have a lot of opportunities in order to gather. And in terms of this international coalition that I'm seeking to put together. And in that, I'm seeking oboists from a variety of different backgrounds who are emerging in their field, but also also leaders in their own communities. And this is a very, I'm sure as you have figured that this is a very, very grassroots organization and projects, and being able to reach internationally through these oboists who have put together, who have come together and talked about our differences. And what I think is really interesting in this opportunity with oboists specifically is that in terms of where you are in the world, playing the oboe is almost a different instrument. So the American sound or the US sound is completely different than the sounds of the oboe that you would hear in Germany and that you would hear in New Zealand and that you would hear in China. And I think being able to come together and talk about those things and foster almost a unity in our in industry is pivotal in this project. I hope that answers part of your question.
Yes, thank you, Allison. Mm-hmm.
This is a wonderful project, Allison. Thank you so much for sharing your ideas here. I'm wondering if there are any organizations that are already doing, you know, similar work in amplifying the works of composers of color as well as women composers. And if there are any organizations that you've kind of looked to, if you could maybe just share some of those names.
Absolutely. So there's actually a flute commissioning consortium that I actually found following my idea, and it's doing very much of much similar work to what I envisioned doing. And right now they're actually working on a project with Valerie Coleman called Amazonian Woman, I believe. And
basically it creates a map of a performance map of where the piece will be played. And I very much hope to be doing similar work in that. I hope that answers your question as well.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Just some kind of nuts and bolts questions. So you talk about a commissioning consortium. Do you imagine that the money is coming from the oboe players that are going to perform this music, or are you planning on raising money outside? And sort of how do you buy into the consortium, and how does that part work?
So I hope to be doing both. I hope to be professionally recording, all of us professionally recording, especially premieres, and supplying those recordings to the composers. And through this, applying for grants, being able to apply for grants in order to help fund the project. But the idea of the consortium is to raise funds through these oboe players, who will then also get the performance rights of the work. And I think this kind of goes back to Clive's question in terms of being able to kind of amplify these performances and getting these performance rights for the work, as well as raising the money in the process.
The 5-to-1 project is a multicultural partnership between universities in the United States and indigenous communities in Oaxaca, Mexico. This project will allow me to create social change by addressing music education, all while creating mutual learning experiences and diversifying the classical music world in the U.S. I had the opportunity to visit the indigenous village of Sololcho, where my parents grew up for the first time last summer. This village consists of two music schools where children as young as 4 years old are dropped off by their parents. The community then comes together to provide food, shelter, and a musical instrument for them. Seeing how driven and passionate these kids were changed my life. I've never seen a group of children so excited to wake up at 5 in the morning and stay up as late as 1 a.m. making music every single day. Many of them don't get to see their families throughout the school year, and overcoming poverty is only possible through their musical instrument, which is why I felt the need to become involved. Now, I understand that community engagement programs already exist for underserved communities and universities, but one of the biggest challenges is getting students involved. At USC, for example, in a population of over 1,000 students, only about 70 participate annually. With this partnership, a much higher participation rate will be possible, considering all education will be done remotely. And I believe we can successfully provide this because I've experienced firsthand how impactful remote learning could be from the Music Academy this summer. Now, my plan consists of two phases. I've begun phase one, and I've created relationships with the music directors and children. Now, for the next part of this phase, I hope to get about 15 to 25 of my musician friends involved. Now, the village already has a wind ensemble, so phase two will consist of expanding the complement of instruments, culminating into a full orchestra. I plan on doing this by reaching out to school districts where music programs may have been cut, because I know that many of them have donated instruments in their past. I believe that these two phases can be completed within the next year and a half, and once they are, I plan to raise additional funds to expand staff, get more equipment, and create a festival. Now, it might sound like I'm suggesting we provide a program for these young kids, but what I'm really suggesting is that we also provide this program for ourselves, and that we take the time to learn about this community's culture, music, and traditions. By doing so, we will not only give these kids the gift of hope and opportunity, but we'll be able to diversify our repertoire of musical knowledge in order to bring new audiences into the classical music world. One of the reasons this project is so meaningful to me is because I stand here as a Music Academy Fellow as a byproduct of one of these programs. My grandfather, my dad, and I all developed our love for music from indigenous bands. And to this day, I still enjoy making music in these bands with my dad. Although I didn't receive classical training until much later, I have been extremely fortunate to have received such a high-quality musical education that I want to create the same experience for someone like me, so that they'll be able to do what they love and make music for the rest of their lives.
Javier, thank you for that. Very inspiring project and very inspiring personal story connected to it. I wonder, when you think about this, when you were doing your research, are there other programs that are similar that that you learned from that could accelerate the success of this? I'm just curious.
Well, I think a lot of the programs that exist in underserved communities, more so in cities. But I think that what happens is that many of the people doing this work don't actually go into these indigenous villages because they don't know that they exist. And it's like they don't even know where to begin with. But because of my experience and my culture and my family, they grew up there. And, you know, I have a really deeply personal connection with them and that community. So I believe I can be the first to kind of get into and start this program with Indigenous communities where, you know, not many people would go into.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for this. And I was definitely fighting back some tears while watching your pitch. And you spoke so from the heart about it, and it really resonated. So thank you.
Thank you.
I love your project more than because of the sort of paying it forward, providing access, providing opportunity, but also because of the cultural exchange aspect of it. And I was wondering if you could speak just a little bit about, you know, what you would hope people participating in this program would gain in terms of sort of cultural enrichment. And my part B question is, as you were speaking about building an ensemble kind of format that eventually becomes an orchestra, sort of in your dream world, in terms of a virtual format, if the world still requires that, you know, for some time, have you given any thought to how that might pivot?
Yeah, well, I think what I'm aiming to do within the next year and a half is actually fundraising in order to kind of create this in-person festival at some point. But what I'm planning to do is hosting webinars, which is most feasible right now because of the pandemic, where we teach people about the culture, the music, the dances, just everything about the community. And I think that because so many universities right now are kind of stuck and they don't know, they're not having ensembles for say the next semester, the next year, nobody knows. So what I hope to do is establish relationships with them and see if they're willing to host these webinars and see if they're willing to host guest lecturers, you know, maybe some of the music directors, the children, so then that we can hear their stories. And if they're not, then hopefully they can also just promote these webinars to the students that are interested. And I think one of the other ways I plan on kind of raising this cultural awareness is actually playing these arrangements and hosting benefit concerts with myself and others from my community. And, you know, talking about the music, the history, everything. And then I think for another part that's important to me is actually promoting this Indigenous music on a much larger scale. And I think universities often don't know where to start or how to even contact these Indigenous composers or that they even exist. So what I'm planning to do is I'm planning on telling them, hey, you know what, like I'm planning to offer them a solution and telling them about this program, about these music directors doing great work with the kids. I'm planning on telling them they have a variety of works that they'll be able to promote. And all around, it'll be a win-win-win. A win for the universities trying to diversify the music, a win for the music directors and their compositions, and a win for the community engagement program, because I believe that we can successfully provide this and kind of build this relationship with everyone.
Thank you.
Yeah, this incredible project. It's just really exciting to hear about it. Can you kind of talk a little bit about like what your short-term goals are, especially in terms of connecting with those universities?
Yeah, so short-term goals, as I mentioned, is just kind of establishing relationships so that, you know, within the next year, we can kind of raise this cultural awareness and within students and also staff and music organizations. So that would be my short-term goal within the next year. And hopefully we'll be able to raise money so that, you know, maybe we can get started and jumpstart this within the next, maybe the 21-22 school year. So then that will, and my hope is to raise about $30,000. So then, and that will provide the technology to actually get us started. And it'll also provide about 10 hours of instruction per week for the whole semester. Or for the whole school year for these kids.
Hi, my name is Christina and I'm a tuba player. I'm writing a book to document the legacies of 13 historic female brass players, and I would like your help.
I'm the first female tubist to attend the Curtis Institute of Music since it was founded in 1924, and I've never seen another woman at a professional audition. However, I can guarantee you that if you walk into your local middle school, you will see young girls playing brass instruments. Very few people still believe that women cannot play loud and powerful instruments, and yet the brass profession is still dominated by men. I believe that the reason for this is deeply rooted in the way that young brass musicians are educated. Students learn from reading famous pedagogical and biographical texts about brass players, but most well-read texts are written by men about men. Why would a young girl want to, or even believe she could pursue a career as a brass musician when the pedagogy is not relevant to her? Why would a male brass player show respect to his female colleagues when he's never had a female role model? Even if a young woman pursues a career in brass, when she goes long enough facing prejudice from her colleagues and without seeing anyone like her succeed, she starts to believe that there isn't a place for her at the top. It is precisely because of this that the glass ceiling has not been shattered. But here's the good news. There are a number of women in brass who have, since the 1950s, succeeded at the highest level. Their legacy and their stories are unwritten, which has left a gaping hole in brass education that perpetuates the cycle of patriarchy. I would like to amend that, and the even better news is that already, 9 of the 10 living women I plan to write about have formally agreed to be included.
Velvet Brown's 4 solo albums have changed tuba playing. In 1980, Abby Conant won principal trombone of the Munich Philharmonic. Barbara Butler is the most sought-after trumpet teacher in the world. Rebecca Cherian was a soloist with the San Francisco Symphony at age 17. Gail Williams was associate principal horn in Chicago, and now people are afraid of her students. Susan Slaughter's principal trumpet career was the second longest in history. Ava Ordman was 19 when she won her principal trombone job. Marie Speziale was the first woman trumpeter in an American orchestra. When Julie Lansman won principal horn of the Met, she was the first woman in their brass section. Betty Glover played bass trombone with the Cincinnati Symphony. Helen Kotes Kirsch won principal horn of the Chicago Symphony. Connie Weldon played tuba with the Royal Concertgebouw. Dorothy Ziegler won principal trombone in St. Louis in 1944, and Ethel Merka did way too many things to say in 3 seconds.
In the next few months, I'm going to deep dive into the legacies of these women. This project will have 3 components: research, writing, and promoting. I began in June by contacting each of these women with my proposal, and I'm so thrilled by their response and by their willingness to embark on this project with me. This week, I will hire an assistant to help me collect biographical information. Once I draft each woman's biography, I will begin their interview process online, hopefully followed by an in-person visit when it's safe. After each woman's biographical piece is complete, I will collect testimonies from former students and colleagues. I anticipate that my financial needs during the research and writing processes will largely be covered with the stipend I've already received from Marley. I will have finished the first draft around this time next year, at which point I will be able to begin editing, building a website, contacting publishers, and finding pathways to promote the book. And this is where the Fast Pitch Award comes in. The $1,500 from Fast Pitch and the experience in the Innovation Residential will help me navigate this finalizing process and create a product that is not only a relevant resource to brass players, but a commodity to all musicians. I believe in this project as a vital step toward gender equality in the field, and I hope you do as well.
Hi, thanks, Christina.
Hi, thanks so much.
Just wondering a little bit about who the audience is, because you mentioned a couple different things. One is sort of young people, you know, needing to look up to older people in the field, and then also sort of being a vital resource for professional musicians. So who do you see as the audience for this book?
Yeah, I mean, initially, I think that the most important audience is students, because this is really an educational endeavor. But having said that, you know, I think that this project is relevant to every musician, especially because the resilience that these women have had to have in their careers to get to where they were is kind of mind-boggling. And, you know, especially in the climate that we're in right now, where the world is changing and where people need a little extra resilience, you know, I think that this project can be really important for all musicians.
So professionals, though, sort of?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Hi, Christina. Thank you so much for this. I'm wondering, when you were thinking about who to highlight, how did you pick these particular women? What was important about these particular stories that you're leaning in on?
Sure. So I think the first thing is that these 13 women are kind of the only ones within their generation. So the criteria that I used was basically people who either were orchestral musicians with tenured positions, or people who have significant orchestral influence, say like Barbara Butler, whose students, she has students in almost every orchestra in the United States. And so that was the first criteria. And then the second criteria was their age. So I was looking for people active between 1940 and 1990. And many of the living women are about, you know, in their 70s now. And there are a few who are deceased as well, who I would like to bring to light.
Christina, thank you so much. First of all, congratulations on blazing new trails at Curtis. We're so lucky to have you. The world is lucky to have you. My question is about distribution beyond just a book, because as I was listening to your pitch, I was like, well, and it's going to be a podcast, and it's going to be a Netflix documentary, and it's going to be this and this and this and this. And so when your wildest dreams of this going out into the world are fulfilled, where will we have seen this project?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I've thought about it too, of course. The reason that I'm focusing first on the book is actually because I have had a very personal impact from a book that's very similar. It's Arnold Jacob's Song and Wind, which is a very popular brass book about a very famous tuba pedagogue. And you know, I remember being in my undergrad, and in our studio there was a bookshelf full of books, and that's sort of where I found my inspiration. So that's the reason why I am starting with that, but I would love for it to be an audiobook. I plan on having an Instagram and social media as well as a website just to promote it. And of course, I mean, if I could get a film and podcast, you know, it's totally a dream of mine. And I'm hoping that this project is just the start of a greater commitment.
Please do. And, you know, we actually just commissioned a new piece for 15-piece brass ensemble at Lincoln Center. And as we were piecing together the ensemble, we were like, where are the women? So please do this for the world. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm pleased to announce that the judges have reached a decision on the three winners for tonight, and we will be announcing them in no particular order. And I would love for my fellow judges to help me in announcing the winner. So let's start with Ariel.
All right, yeah. So first person to be announced is Jay.
Woo. Thank you, Ariel. Nadia.
Next winner is Javier Morales-Martinez.
Congratulations, Javier.
I have the pleasure of announcing Christina Daugherty for her book on the legacies of women in brass. So congratulations to everyone. It was very inspiring.
Congratulations all. And also congratulations to all of our fellows and for their wonderful ideas that they shared with us this evening. Regardless of whether or not you were chosen as a top three tonight, we invite you to please submit to the Alumni Enterprise Awards for a chance for even greater support. And that concludes our program for this evening. So on behalf of the Music Academy family, thank you for joining us for this wonderful night of innovation and inspiration, and see you very soon.